Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath to all of you. This message of encouragement is not just to you who are sitting in the congregation, but also to those who are watching from home. And first of all, we miss you. We miss seeing you here with us. But this encouragement is a message that comes from Hebrews 10, verse 25. And it says, "Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the great day approaching." You know, since COVID-19 has come into existence, Sabbath school is a great time to be together, to share ideas with like believers. It's a wonderful time to encourage each other and to be able to share your own ideas as well. At 9:30, we begin with either a mission story or a video mission spotlight, or someone will have prepared interesting thoughts or a presentation. So I just want to encourage you, set that alarm clock a little bit earlier so that you can be here at 9:30 when Sabbath school begins, because we all miss you.
Good morning. Should we just bow our heads for a short prayer to ask God to be with us in a special way? Dear Father, we ask you to be with us this morning as we come into your house to worship you and to praise you and to thank you for the many, many things you have done for us in our life, especially for sending your son to die, giving us our plan of salvation. Send your Holy Spirit in a special way, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to welcome everybody here this morning, especially like to welcome our visitors. Our pastor will do a special welcome when he is coming to give his sermon. But thank you for being here. It's a good day to be alive and to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? The thought I wanted to leave with you, one of my favorite quotes from Ellen White, in dealing with different problems in our life, and we've all dealt with things. Many things have happened in the last couple of years with COVID and the amount of deaths we've had to deal with and illness. But Ellen White says, God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory of the purpose which they are fulfilling as co-workers with him. We don't understand many times in this life why things happen, but we have to get to a point where we accept God's leading. I was reading in this morning in the book that Oswald Chambers had written. And he said that that we have to fill our minds with the fact that God knows, God's there, and God cares. That God is with us regardless of where we are in our circumstances, and that sometimes we have made bad choices, but as we see as he led Israel, he can lead you out of bad choices too. We have something special that's not in the bulletin this morning. We're going to have a baptism this morning, which is a very, very special occasion. And our pastor is going to introduce the candidate.
Good morning, church. Why, it's always good to see my people. And we have, as Ed mentioned, a very special Sabbath today. Sabbath in which we all rejoice. And I'd like to introduce our baptismal candidate, Carlene Robinson. I'd like to make a motion that we accept her as a member of our church upon baptism. If I get a second, it's been seconded. All in favor, please raise your hands and give her a good round of applause. So we'll get ready. And yes, Linda, you got that special token. Thank you so much. We'll continue with the program.
Amen. I'd like you to take your bulletins, and the insert sheet has a list of those who are in need of prayer. And we have Betty Morin, Charlie Serswin, Brad Gary, Sheila Moody, Diane Moore, and Ruth Trimbley as members. Then you'll see a list of those who are shut-ins and a list of family members. We also need to add to that list Dawn Hurlston. Dawn, we got word this morning that Dawn is in Palm Bay Hospital with a bacterial infection, and we need to remember him. Dawn has been through a lot of things, including a kidney transplant a few years ago, and all our lives are in the hands of God, but we need to remember him. And Betty, I understand, is at home now. How's Betty doing?
She's doing much better.
Good. Beginning to recover. She went through pneumonia and COVID, right? And it was very serious for a number of weeks. Anybody else we need to remember in our prayer this morning? Charlie, yeah, I mentioned Charlie.
Mm-hmm.
That's a terrible situation. We need to remember them. Thank you. Anyone else? Wherever possible, shall we kneel for prayer? Dear Father, we thank you this morning for your love for us. We thank you for being here with us this morning, for always being with us, for creating a plan of salvation when we can, no matter where we've been, no matter where we came from, you have a plan for us. Lord, we pray that you will be with the people we mentioned in a special way. There are some very, very serious illnesses and circumstances. And Lord, only you can have the answers for some of these problems. We thank you, Lord, for this church here this morning. We ask that you send your Holy Spirit in a special way. Touch our hearts. Be with our pastor as he delivers the message. We thank you for the baptism, and be with Carlene in a special way as she goes through baptism. We pray, Lord, that as we look around us, we see the world melting down. We pray, Lord, that someday soon that you will return and take us all home with you, and we can spend eternity with each other and with you, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I know Dawn is not here to play the organ. Our opening song, opening hymn, is 425.
Hello, let's stand for opening hymn. That number again is 425. be seated.
What a perfect song to sing just before a baptism. There is truly joy in heaven, isn't there, when we give our hearts to the Lord.
Lord, and help me on my way. Give me strength that I might find abiding faith and peace of mind. And I won't ask, where do I go from here? Please lead me through the darkness and through each gloomy day. Take my hand, O precious Lord, and help me on my way. Give me strength that I might find abiding faith and peace of mind, and I won't ask, where do I go from here?
I'd like to ask Marv, if she is here, please come here to the platform with us. Marv is Carlene's aunt, and she would like you to be with us. And if someone can help Marvis to come up to the platform, that'll be great. Marvis, are you with us? Okay, yeah, she is.
I darling, I'm so happy. I'm happy for you. And may God bless you and keep you strong and in faith with love and hope that one day we will be with our Savior. Okay? And I love you. God bless you.
Dear Carlene, you've been searching the scriptures. You've been walking with the Lord. You've been waiting for this moment. And the time has come in which you will tell this church, in which you will tell the world that you have followed Jesus and you want to follow him for the rest of your life. That you want to give your life to him, that you want to be an example to others so that they can also get to know him as Savior and Lord. One of your favorite texts is found in Psalm 27:1, where it says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And indeed, when you find Jesus, and when you depend on him, and your life is completely sealed with Jesus, no one and nothing can do anything against you because you have the Savior on your side. It's a privilege as a minister of the gospel in the Seventh-day Adventist Church to baptize you this morning in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I know that there is more. There's more people that I'm starting with. And there's more people that I probably have not started starting yet. But if you're one of those that are listening to the voice of the Lord, Holy Spirit talking to you and convincing you that with him, there is no life whatsoever, I invite you to consider giving God the first and the best part of your life. If you want to start studying the Bible, please talk to me, talk to one of the elders. We'll be more than happy to help you. Let's continue with the service.
What an exciting thing to have. Baptism is one of the most special things that we have in our church. Imagine the joy in heaven. The joy for every one of us that are here this morning. It's time for our tithes and offerings, and we ask the deacons to come forward. As you prepare to give your offerings, think of how God has led you. My wife is pointing to me that the children's story is next. I'm all mixed up. I haven't been up here for several months. And with the baptism added in, I scrambled things around. So we'll give the children a chance for their offerings first. So if the children could get their baskets in the back and come forward, we'll have a children's story, and then we'll we'll have our offering.
All right. Whoa, somebody have their ears on. Yes. Good morning, boys and girls. Very good. I have a phrase I want to teach you, but I think most of you know it already. I am going to say, God is good, and you say? Seriously? All right, guys. No, not awesome yet. We'll get to awesome. I'll say God is good, and you will say? All the time. And then I would say all the time, and you would say? Okay, let's try it. God is good. And all the time. And that's a true statement. And I can tell you about that because I've been through a lot of it. Now, I just came back from this place called St. Lucia. Yeah, you don't know where it is. It's down the sea a little ways from Puerto Rico and Haiti and Jamaica and all those other countries, and it is filled with mountains, not hills, mountains. Now, here's the strange thing. People go over those mountains to get to various different towns, but you don't drive up and over the mountain. You drive around and around. It's a winding road as you wind your way up, and then at the top, you have to wind your way down. So they cut the roads at the mountains. Now, here's the deal. On one side of the road, there's this cliff. It just goes up. And on the other side of the road, there's what? Way, way down there. And guess what? They don't have no guardrails. So it's really fun, you know, when you're driving around there, because sometimes you come into a curve and you actually have to toot your horn to let the person know, because somewhere on the other side may be somebody who decides, I can overtake this car in front of me and get back in before I hit the bend. And it gets a little crazy. Now, I'm a chicken. I don't drive in St. Lucia. At any time, a tree can come down one of those cliffs and just land across the road. We had just come from a town called Castries, and we were heading back home, me and my wife, Angie. And as we turned this bend, there across the road laid a tree, just minding its own business. Don't know how it got there, but laying across the road. A car before us had stopped at it, and the guy was trying to move it, but it was obviously too much for him. So I stopped my car. We got out. We started talking for a little bit, and then we decided we'd put our backs to it and move this tree, which no big deal, right? Until you hear, bomb, bomb. What do you think's coming up that hill? No, not just a truck. A big truck. And he's carrying a big load, like an 18-wheeler. And when they start up those hills, they don't stop. Because if you stop, it takes a long time for you to creep back up to speed to get up that winding hill. So they don't stop. And we hear them coming. I looked at the guy. He looked at me. Humped that tree up, picked it up, ran it off to the side of the road. And just as we were about to drop it, we heard again. This time it was a whole lot closer. Bomb, bomb. He let the tree go right away. He just let it go. He ran back to his car, jumped into his car, hit that accelerator, and he was gone. I'm running back to my car, and Angie's sitting in the car waiting, and she knows it's coming because she heard it too. And as I am approaching the car, I see the truck turn the corner. What am I going to do? Now, in St. Lucia, the driving wheel is on the other side of the car. So the passenger side is where the driver's side would be. I was so scared I got disoriented. And I ran to the side where she was, trying to open the door and get in. But it was too late. I didn't have time to run around to the other side. That truck was coming. And I said to her, go, go, go! And so she took off because she couldn't stay there. So she took off, and while she's driving, I'm running behind, and I'm looking at that big truck, and I'm running behind. Now, you can't pull off to the side of the road, because on the side of the road with the cliff, there's a ditch. The reason for the ditch is so when the water comes down the hill, it hits the ditch, and they can direct the water where to go, so it doesn't wash out the road. Pretty smart, huh? But on the other side is the... And you don't want to pull over near that. So she got in the car, and she just started driving. She got around the first U-bend, and as she got around that bend, there was a straight pathway. And if the road is straight, you can stay on one side of it, and the truck would actually move around and just, you know, pass you nice and safely, which is what happens. And I finally come running up to the car, all out of breath. And the reason I got out of breath so quickly was because I was so afraid. Man, it's kind of like you see this thing happening, and then they say your life flashed before your eyes. So many things flash before your face because so much stuff can happen. That guy, he is not going to stop. I mean, he drove by us. He saw us. He drove by, and he just pulled his horn with a big smile on his face. Bom, bom. He had no idea. He had no idea there was a tree in the road. He had no idea what we just did. He had no idea what could have happened. But I did. Yes, God is good. We normally start our days with prayer, and as we pray, we ask God to lead us, guide us, and protect us. And sometimes people think, you know, you just say that in the prayer, lead, guide, and protect me, lead, guide, and protect me. And no, it's not just a prayer. Psalms 91:11, he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in their way. They shall bear you up in their arms, lest you dash your feet upon a stone. The angels of God are the ones who help us over situations and things we don't even know. Does anybody know what's going to happen today? You don't know what's going to happen today? You're going to sit here, you're going to hear a sermon, then what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You're going to go home, and then what are you going to do? Eat, and then what are you going to do? Then you're going to go to sleep, then what are you going to do? See, that's all your plans, right? You're going to listen to the sermon, go home, eat, go to sleep, maybe go for a walk or whatever. That's your plan, right? But what if things were to change? What if you got sick? What if your car broke down and you can't get home? We don't know. So when we ask God to lead, guide, and protect us, we are really asking him to do something that's real. And we have a God, oh my goodness, listen, God is good and all the time, no matter what. So today, enjoy the goodness of God. Amen? All right, you may go quietly to your seats.
Now we'll ask the deacons to come forward for our morning offering. Those of you who are watching online, The church website has provisions for you to give your offerings online, and those of you who are here this morning can use that also. Just go to the church website, and you'll see the tab that you can click on. So we ask the deacons to come forward as we will say our prayer, and you've had plenty of time to think about your offering now. Think about how God has blessed us. Dear Father, we thank you this morning for the many, many blessings you have given us individually and as a church. Lord, we pray your guidance as we give our offerings. We pray your blessing. We pray that you will multiply these offerings. We pray that they can finish your work so we can go home with you soon. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I was wondering where the music was going to come from when I heard Don was in the hospital, but the Lord provides, doesn't he? What a beautiful offertory. We still have special music, and Ruth is going to bring us our song this morning.
Hello. Okay, it's working.
Could not be hidden. John saw the city. Oh, yes, he did. John caught a glimpse of the golden throne. Tell me more about it. Go right on around the throne. He saw a crystal sea. There's got to be more. What will it be? I want to go to the city he saw, the New Jerusalem. Jerusalem, I want to walk your streets that are golden, and I want to run where the angels have trod. rivers in that city, the city of God. John saw the lion lay down by the lamb. I want to know everything about that land. John saw the day, but he did not see night. The Lamb of God, well, he must be the light. He saw the saints worship the great I Am, crying, worthy, worthy is the Lamb. I want to go to the city he saw, the New Jerusalem. Jerusalem, I want to rest on the banks of your rivers, in that city, the city of God.
Happy Sabbath. So good to see you all. Let me read a few names here. I'm just happy that church in Melbourne, every Sabbath, gets a few visitors, guests, and those who are moving from different states, we're praying and hoping not just like the place and the service and the worship, but you like to also join our church. I'd like to mention Mike and Diana. Help me out with the last name. Is it Reek? Reed, okay. Mike and Diana from Pennsylvania, moving from Pennsylvania. Are you here? Yes. So good to have you with us. Welcome. Welcome indeed. How about Paul Sargent? Paul Sargent, are you with us from Indy Atlantic. Yeah, Paul, here we go. Oh, there you go. And I see here, husband of Beverly. So Beverly, hey, just happy to see you both today in our church. Blessings. Amy and Chris Altadonna from Chattanooga, moving from Chattanooga, now new in the community, attending for the first time. Hey, here you go. I just had a chance to say hello to you both. Welcome. Welcome to the Melbourne Seventh-day Adventist Church. I've heard it ever since I came to this church, that Indiana is the promised land. I think that person is wrong, because I'm thinking Melbourne is the promised land. You came to the right place, and we hope the experience will be one that will bring happiness, but more than that, blessings to you as well. Anybody else? Anybody else who happens to be here for the first time? I did not read your name. James wanted to raise his hand, but yeah, we've seen you before. True. Okay. I think that'll be it. You probably saw my car out there. Usually I try to wash my car as frequently as possible. Every week, I have not been able to wash my car for a reason. What's going on tomorrow? A car wash? And who's sponsoring that? Pathfinders and Adventures. Okay, so you knew that. Oh, okay, so I thought it was only me. Anyways, If you're like me, please come tomorrow. We'll have the Pathfinders and the Adventures, and not only that, but there will be empanadas for sale. And believe me, those empanadas, if you were here when we had a movie on a Saturday night, remember, in the fellowship hall, those empanadas, Jamie and her mom, your mom, there you go. She is the expert. So listen, you come tomorrow, and it's going to be great, all right? Got to keep praying for those who are not with us, those who are still sick. There is a long list. I will not repeat names, but just wanted to say that each and every person that we're praying for, they are so, so thankful and grateful. I speak with them on a weekly basis, more than that sometimes, and every time I hear the same thing, please thank the members of the church. I feel the prayers, and I feel the strength. So let's keep doing that. Some of them are coming out of the woods now. Betty is feeling so much better. I understand that no nurses, no doctors going to her house now, and if you talk to her, She talks like she used to. So it's a lot better. Sheila's doing better. We can tell that God is doing great things. Last week we started a topic on this new series that we just started about three weeks ago, actually, Served to Serve. And today I'd like to continue and finish this topic, Kingdom Greatness. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we've gathered here with a purpose, and we are just expecting the Holy Spirit to touch our minds, our hearts, our lives, so we can do, so we can express, so we can tell what Jesus is all about. Thank you, Jesus, for being with us. Amen. Jerusalem. Wasn't that a powerful song? Thank you, Ruth. Appreciate that. And your talent is just words. We finished last week, actually, terminal with, can you hear me back there now? Okay. Is it better? Okay, good. We talk about greatness is found in selflessness. And then I mention another subtitle, greatness is found in service. All right? And that's where we left it last week. Greatness is found in service. Now, do you know what the acronym GOAT stands for? There you go. It's an abbreviation for greatest of all time. Can you name a few athletes that belong to this list? Michael Jordan, you're with me. We're friends. Yes, sir. Okay, I'll put some pictures and see if you guess who they are. This goes back to 1914 to 1935. Yes, sir. Baseball players, you know him. All right, he is on the list. Greatest of all time. Okay, how about this here? You said what? Michael Jordan. All right. Tom, all right, football players. Okay, golfers. If you play golf, you know this guy, right? Jack what? Yes, indeed. He is on the list. Greatest of all time. Okay. This one here, you must know him. Yes, Federer. Uh-huh. Men's tennis. And how about this? Michael Phelps. Okay, men's swimming. All of these people here belong to the greatest of all time list. But I'd like to suggest that there is a huge difference between greatness as defined by the world and greatness as defined by the Bible. In the book of Mark, chapter 10, verses 41 through 44, which is our text today, Jesus teaches his disciples the difficult truth about greatness. And I say difficult truth because Jesus had taught this before to his disciples time after time, and they did not get it. All right? So let's take a look at verse 41. And it says, and when the ten heard it, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. What did they hear? You remember last week we talked about this? What was it? Oh, there you go. There you go. So they were what? Displeased. They were not happy. Now, keep in mind that John and James did not get it. They desired greatness given to them. So they said, Lord, can we have the greatest positions of honor? They were thinking about themselves rather than thinking about others. So the other 10 disciples, as the Bible says,
They were right to be angry. They were right to be upset with James and John. After all, the other 10 got it, didn't they? They were much more servant-minded, weren't they? The answer is no. If we look at verse 42, we'll find out what's going on here. Because Jesus began to admonish them. And when I say them, he admonished the 12 disciples, all of them. All right? Not only James and John, but he was talking to all of them. That means, listen to me now, that means that the 10 were not angry with James and John nearly as much as they were angry with themselves. You know why? Because they had not thought about that first. That's what's going on here. James and John had beaten them to the punch, and they were now experiencing that kind of feeling that kids do. You know, when kids are going to the car, you know, and before you get to the door, one of the kids says, "Dad, I want to be in the front seat." The other ones are what? "What in the world? How come he came up with that before I did? Didn't even give me a chance." That's exactly what happened to the other 10. They were angry because they wanted exactly what James and John had asked for, but they did not do it first. So in verse 42, Jesus reminds them about true greatness and what worldly greatness looks like. But Jesus called them to himself and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them." In other words, Jesus is saying, take a look around you. That's what he's saying. Okay? Look at the way the so-called great men of this world, and he's talking about the great men in his era, those who were around them, those around them, look at the way they treat others. Look at how they think only of themselves. Look at how they ignore the needs of those around them. Look around and see who these great people are, how they reach to the top by standing on the back of others. So the disciples started to get what Jesus was talking about. Because they were Jews. And they were not ignorant about the way Pharisees and Sadducees treat others. So Jesus was telling them about that worldly greatness. And he says, that greatness is not really all that great. And I believe that is true today as well. Those who are considered great in the world today are usually those who have power, fame, or money. But when we really look at those people, they're not that great at all. I believe there are a lot of unknown people who are much closer to greatness than the so-called great household names. Question: what kind of greatness is it that we want and desire. What kind of greatness do you desire? After Jesus paints a picture, then Jesus tells his disciple in verses 43 and 44 where greatness is really found. And this is what he says. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. Huh. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. For you and I, this is easy to understand. We've heard it, we've read it before, we try to practice it, but for the disciples and for those who were listening to Jesus, this is a different story altogether. What Jesus did, he just dropped a bomb on his disciples, and that bomb continues to cause his followers difficulty up until today. I'll tell you why. Bible says, Jesus says, if you want to be great, if you really want your life to have meaning, if you want to be near to the throne of God, if you want to be close to me, then be a servant. And he says, even a slave. Now, I don't know about you, but that's one of the few things I never dreamed of being when I grew up. Never did. Now, when I was younger, I thought about president. Never happened. Astronaut, maybe. Did not happen. A doctor. Mm-mm. Fireman. A pastor. I never thought about becoming a lawyer, by the way. But I remember in my mind, I went as back as I could, and I don't remember ever once said something like, when I grow up, I want to be a servant. Yeah, better be a slave. Never. And I doubt that you ever said something like that. Yet Jesus says, this is where greatness is found. Being a servant, slave, oh Jesus. Now, let me just make sure. Jesus does not mean that everyone has to run around with that tuxedo. No, that's not what Jesus is talking about. Okay? Or with a maid uniform. That's not what Jesus is talking about. What Jesus says here is that whatever we do, wherever we are, and whoever we are with, we are to care for the needs of others above our own needs. Did you like that? Probably in theory, but in practice? Let's talk about practical ways. When we are at home, I believe we should care and serve our spouses. Do you say amen to that? Women all said amen. Men said nothing. Okay, now I got two or three. Now, husbands, listen to me now. But do you see that picture? She looks exhausted, but him is about to die. Seriously. Now, husbands, talking to you now, serve your wives by helping out around the house. Amen? Show your wife that you love her in practical ways. Amen? Do some dishes, wash some clothes, clean the bathroom, do whatever needs to be done, but show her that you thank God for blessing you with her. I haven't finished yet. Wives, serve your husband by taking interest in him, affirming him. By the way, I don't have to tell you to do some chores or to do things at home because you do that and you love doing that. Of course, you love doing that with the help of your husband as well. All right? But it's one thing to do that, and when it comes to what men need, they need affirmation. I'm not done yet. I'm going to talk to you as parents. Serve your kids. Now, I don't just mean as a bank and a taxi service. No. Serve your kids by taking interest in them. Did you get that? Taking what? Interest in them. Spending time with them. And most importantly, teaching them the ways of God. Church, we ought to serve the people we work with, the people we live next to, the people we see struggling to open their car doors while helping out. I mean, you think about simple ways. If you see a person with two little ones, And he's got a lot of groceries. Please do something. Show that greatness is found in service. It is true. Sometimes people don't want to be served and helped. A few times, we're at Sam's or BJ's, and there is what I consider an older person. And I try to help him with a case of water. And she say, "No thanks, I got it." Good. But if you see that there is need, please remember who you are. But most importantly, and this is something that we have to think about, serve those who do not know about Jesus Christ. What did I say? Serve those who what? Don't know about Jesus Christ. I'll say this. The ultimate form of service is evangelism. Amen? Pastor, what's that? There is no greater act of service than telling someone about Jesus Christ. I'll tell you why, okay? Because when you share the love of Christ, you are serving that person by introducing them to Jesus, who happens to be the fount of life, who happens to be the person who will transform their lives, the person who will give them a totally different perspective of what life's all about. Many of you are into serving others. And if that's you, I say, praise the Lord. But I'd like to mention one person in particular this morning. She's always looking out for those who are in need and are unable to come to our church. Most of the time, this person doesn't send them a card, a get well card. What she does, she takes the cards with her, along with some goodies, and she goes visits some of the shut-ins. All right? Not just that. If there is something that needs to be done in church, she'll gladly do it. Like during the pandemic, remember? For about a year and a half, almost 2 years, our church implemented several procedures to keep the building clean and sanitized before, during, and after every service. All right? And guess who would be on top of everything, making sure that God's people were being protected and safeguarded? By the way, I haven't said the name, you already said it. She was helping with the baptism this morning, as she always does. All right? And she's taking the responsibility, like if she didn't have anything else, she's taking the responsibility to help more than 50 children in our Brevard County every Christmas time with the angel tree. You guessed her name is Linda Arugio. Linda, I'd like to ask you to come here with me. Where are you, Linda? Okay, back there. Linda, I only have one question for you. I'm going to put you on the spot. Question is easy. Why do you do all of that? After all, as far as I remember, this is voluntary work. Mm-hmm. We haven't raised your salary. No. Why do you do all of this? Tell us.
I guess for two reasons. Number one, because Jesus asked me to. And number two is because I read a lot. And one of the last little things I read was that a woman was in prayer, crying to the Lord, "Lord, why is all of this pain? Why is all this trial on the earth? Why don't you send some help?" And the Lord turned around and said, "I did. I sent you."
Amen. Amen. Linda, thank you so much for everything you do. Thank you. Thank you. Let me tell you, it's good to be part of a family of God, isn't it? Now, Linda is not the only one. We have several people like her in our church. But I just wanted to mention her because of the fact that whatever it's needed in church, she'll be on top. Just now. Ruth, remember? We were back there after baptism, waiting for the special music, and she comes with an idea. How about if I put something in here so we can see the bulletin, so we know exactly what's going on, those of us who are back here. I said, that's great. By the way, she put a new clock in there with the time, so we know what to do, when to do, etc., etc. Little things. Always thinking about God's people. Now, some practical ways of helping the community. It's good to help each other out, isn't it? Brothers and sisters, oh, let me tell you, we got to start where? At home. We got to start at home. But we cannot stay home, okay? What we got to do is what? Go out to the community as well. How about if you happen to know of someone who is unable to clean the apartment herself, and she is 85 years old and she needs help and she does not have money to pay someone else? Can you somehow, once in a while, volunteer to help clean up her apartment? These are just ideas, okay? And I'm not telling you that you have to do this. No, I'm just giving you ideas. Remember, greatness is found where? In service. Many times you see people coming back from the market, and they've got quite a few groceries, and they're old, and they're probably looking around to see if there's some help. If you happen to be around, volunteer. Tell them that you gladly help out. Just make sure that you do what Jesus would do. Just make sure that what you do is what Jesus is pleased with. And if you've never done something like that, let me tell you this. You will have the greatest of all experiences, because when you do something for others, you know that God's doing something for you, and then you feel the relation. Greatness, like beauty, is really in the eyes of the beholder. And who is it that we want to see our greatness? Do you want to be great in the eyes of man? Or do you want to be great in the eyes of God? So greatness is found in selflessness, is found in service. And when I talk about service, it's because the main point is what? Helping others. And Jesus concludes this teaching by reminding his disciples that he himself had come for the purpose of others. Okay? That he showed selflessness, that he showed service, but then he showed something else. Greatness is found. Well, it ain't working now. Greatness is found in sacrifice. Okay, here we go. Greatness is found. Let me read verse 45. For even the Son of Man served and to give his life a ransom for many. Amen? Boy, this is powerful. Now that last phrase means that Jesus came to sacrifice his life so that others would live. Amen? Now, there's a word that I want us to pay attention to. The word ransom. Okay? Can anybody tell me what that is? I'm going to do like James has told me to do. I'm going to say something real fast so nobody understands, and everybody will say yes. Ransom. Okay, someone said payment. You're absolutely right. This is the definition of ransom. Purchase price of a slave. It was the price paid for a slave who was then set free by the one who had bought him. You get that? It's not paying a price to keep him for himself, but it's paying a price for what? For freedom. And here is a Bible study about this, ransom. The reason Jesus puts it this way is because the Bible teaches that all mankind is in bondage to sin, right? I'll give you a few texts here. John chapter 8, verse 34. If any commits sin, he is what? What? Slave to sin. So the question is, who commits sin? All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're all slaves. We've all sinned. And our sin has a penalty. And that penalty is what? The wages of sin is death. Simple Bible text that you and I know. All right? But that's what our sin deserves. That's what the Bible says. We ought to be punished by death. So Jesus comes, and he takes that punishment for us. That's the beauty of the gospel. That's the beauty of salvation. He lays down his life for us, dying on the cross, taking the full weight of the sin, and thereby we have been set free. John chapter 8, verse 36 says, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Jesus gives his life as a ransom for many. He dies so that those who follow him may go free. I said the ultimate purpose of service, okay, was evangelism, to share Christ with others. I'm going to say something else. Dying for others is the supreme aspect of greatness. Dying for others is the supreme aspect of greatness. Just recently, the 4th of July, no one can properly explain why a patriotic celebration turned into a day of tragedy in Highland Park, Illinois. 7 people died, 39 injured. You read the stories. You saw it on the news. You probably read the story of this little boy. You probably read the story of this little boy. All right? His name is Aiden McCarthy. You know how old is he? 2. 2 years old. Both parents were killed. And now he's an orphan. The Bible teaches that we live in a fallen world. The Bible teaches that sinful men are capable of doing horrendous things. God promises to one day completely stamp out all evil. And until that time, he has entrusted you and I as a church with the task of sharing freedom and salvation in Jesus Christ. But even as we deal with the senseless nature of these tragedies, it's not just one. We've been seeing more and more tragedies like this happening. We see these shootings everywhere. We ought to be encouraged as well to hear about stories of heroism. And you've heard them. Stories of those who put themselves last and put others first, modeling the greatness that is found in selflessness, service, and sacrifice. Jesus says, "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus came for others. But I'll say it better. Jesus came for you, for me. He came to take care of your sins, and he came to take care of my sins, of your guilt, of my guilt, of your shame. And you know what he did? He did something that we're used to see, but we cannot really comprehend. He placed his body in harm's way, taking upon himself the punishment meant for you and I. He takes it upon himself. But then he encourages us to look at Calvary's cross, where we can find freedom in him, because greatness is found in sacrifice. I'm sorry, John. I'm not talking about John Lacey. I'm talking about this John, the beloved disciple. He's been here standing right next to me, and he's been here for a whole week waiting to conclude the sermon, and I had not given him a chance. He started, I took cover, and he's been waiting and waiting. So even though I've been rude, John, you go ahead. What does John have to tell us? What I have to tell you is this. It wasn't long after my request that Jesus revealed to me of the important lessons of being a Christian. It wasn't long after I came to him and I said, "I want to be the great one. I want to be right next to you. I don't care about anybody else. I care about me." It wasn't long after that when he taught me what really being a Christian is all about. He taught me one thing. I'll tell you, Pastor, and I'll tell you, congregation. Being a Christian is not about being better than someone else. It's not about having a more superior position, nor is it about having power or someone to rule over. That concept changed my mind. That concept put me in a different position, in a different place. Now, for the first time, I'm understanding what to be a follower of Jesus is all about. Because up until this point, I had been following Jesus for my own personal benefit. And that is just the truth. Now, don't get me wrong. There are benefits when we follow Jesus. And the best of all is the fact that when you follow Jesus and when you give your life to Him, like Carlene did today, then we know that we will be with God forever because Jesus has done for you and I what we cannot. And because of that reason, I don't have to worry if I'm good enough. I don't have to worry if I measure up. I don't have to worry about what else needs to be done. Being a follower of Jesus is not about focusing on yourself or what you like and how you like it. We don't just have a relationship with Jesus so that we can have benefits. That's not the point. In fact, following Jesus, we ought to learn to live a life of service to others, no matter who we are, and no matter who the other person is. And I'll say, this is a special type of service. I'll tell you why. The reality is, every single day people are serving us. But most of the time they're serving us so they can get something from us or they can benefit from someone else. But Jesus taught me differently. It's not the approach of service that Jesus taught me. The type of service Jesus is encouraging me is to leave out is to leave out as someone who is serving others so that they can benefit. Did you get that? Serving others so that they can what? So it's not about me. It's about what Jesus can do in them. Church, online church, the more I get to know Jesus, the more I realize that serving others was not some demeaning experience, but is the important thing to do. It's a great way for God and the other people in our life to connect. It's a great way that we can somehow fellowship together, but more than that, it's a great way to realize that there are so many waiting to hear about Jesus. I pray that you look forward with the joy to a life of serving others. Serving others in love. Serving others so that they can benefit. Because after all, that's what Jesus did. Pastor David, back to you. Thanks, John. John Lacey. I'll just close with this quote from Dwight L. Moody. The measure of a man is not how many servants he has, but how many men he serves. We're going to sing first and then conclude with a prayer.
625. Higher ground. You may stand. I'm pressing on.
Let us pray together. Our Heavenly Father, it's with gratitude that we come to you. Because the more we read the Bible, the more we realize that you want our Christianity to be shown in practical ways. We've learned that greatness is found in selflessness, is found in service, is found in sacrifice. And the best example of all is Jesus Christ. We want to follow Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.